If any orchestra is to play properly, the musicians need to be sure that their instruments are perfectly in tune with each other. When things go well, the sounds are gloriously synchronized and seamless. But imagine what would happen if just one of those 100 or so instruments sounded too tinny, too loud, too low, too weak. What if the instrument went missing, or too many of them showed up? This mishap kind of describes the chaos that reigns when one of the 20,000 plus genes in our body goes awry. Each gene encoded in our DNA instructs our cells to produce proteins and other factors. Usually, these genes function properly, but sometimes a gene changes slightly. We call this a variant, and this alters the way it behaves in the cells. Consider Huntington's disease, the neurodegenerative disease that claimed the life of Woody Guthrie, the American singer-songwriter. It is caused by a single defective gene on chromosome 4. Nearly 1,600 different mutations in the cystic fibrosis transmembrane conductance regulator gene can cause cystic fibrosis, a disease that impacts the lung's ability to function. Fortunately, advances in technology and years of trial and error have brought us to a point where we finally have therapies available in the clinic that, generally speaking, are designed to cure genetic diseases by replacing or supplementing problematic genes. There are now gene therapies that treat a handful of disorders, including neuromuscular diseases and inherited blindness.
What is gene therapy? So, at its simplest, it's an approach to correcting genetic disorders. So most commonly people think of that as gene replacements, so genetic diseases which are caused by the absence of a functioning protein. The most common ones people would maybe have heard about, thought about, are the hemophilias, Duchenne's muscular dystrophy. And so those are disorders where replacing the defective gene replacement aspects can be approached. But there are also genetic disorders where it is a mutant protein or an overexpressed protein that's driving the pathology. So again, we could think there something like Huntington's disease. And in these approaches, gene therapy is not replacing an absent protein, it is altering or tuning the expression of an endogenous protein gene that it's not performing as we would be wished. So there are a number of approaches to gene therapy. The one I suppose that's most commonly discussed at the moment is the application of AAV, virally vector gene therapies. And these are administered by IV infusion, for example, and target, for example, the liver and produce the therapeutic protein from the liver. But there are other approaches. So a number of companies work with non-viral systems. And those are, for example, liposome encapsulated mRNAs that encode a therapeutic protein. And so those are alternative approaches to delivering a gene therapy. The other approach, and maybe the third approach, is ex vivo gene therapy. And so this is, for example, for blood disorders, so things like beta thalassemia, where you take hematopoietic stem cells from a patient, a gene is engineered into them, introduced into those cells ex vivo to fix a genetic defect, and those stem cells are then returned to the patient.
The Boston Area Foundation, Cure Rare Disease, is coordinating efforts with academic labs, led by Yale University, and industry partners, including Charles River, to customize gene therapies for individuals with Duchenne muscular dystrophy. This is a rare neuromuscular disease caused by the body's inability to make the protein dystrophin, which is critical for the structure and function of muscle cells. The gene therapy is designed to turn on a section of DNA that can override the damaged part of the DNA. The scientists are working towards restoring normal production of dystrophin and hopefully altering the progression of patients like Terry Horgan, the brother of Cure Rare Disease's founder and CEO, Richard Horgan.
So the story of why I became involved in this initiative and why I started Cure Rare Disease is incredibly personal. My younger brother, Terry, is impacted by a rare form of a rare disease called Duchenne Muscular Dystrophy. And for those that aren't aware, Duchenne Muscular Dystrophy, or DMD as it's commonly abbreviated, it is a disease that saps one's muscles. Now, everything in your body is a muscle, essentially, or 40% of your body is a muscle, more specifically. The arms that you hold the paper with, the legs that you walk down the hallway with, the heart that pumps blood through your body are all muscles. And this disease destroys muscle. And so having and being a part of a family that's been impacted by this disease, not only with my brother, but also my mother's three brothers and her mother's brother before that, it's something that's haunted my family now for generations. And with the opportunity to go to Harvard Business School, I had the chance, or at least the opportunity, to try and fight back against this disease. The way in which my brother Terry has been affected by Duchenne is immense, to put it frankly. As a young boy, Terry struggled to keep up with his peers, to walk as far or to run as much as his peers could. And so as a child, you don't really understand what disease is. My brother Terry is 3 years younger than I am. And so I grew up with him suffering from this disease. And at first you don't really notice it. But then as you get older and as he got older and as the disease progressed, you start to notice that he's not as fast. He's not able to do some of the other things that boys in his age are able to do. And that really impacted my childhood a lot. It really framed and impressed upon me the cost of disease on a personal basis, not just as an abstract concept. And it imbued in me a sense of determination and passion to end this disease.
Terry's dystrophin gene is missing a piece of DNA that starts in the region called the muscle promoter, which is necessary for turning on the production of dystrophin in muscles. Fortunately for Terry, we have backup versions of this gene in our DNA. The Yale team is using an advanced version of the gene editing technology known as CRISPR, called CRISPR activation, to specifically target a brain isoform of exon 1 and turn it on. In Terry's gene therapy, the CRISPR activation can target the dystrophin gene using a guide RNA molecule, and a modified Cas9 enzyme can turn on production of dystrophin. So far, researchers have shown the treatment works in both a cell line of Terry's developed by the University of Massachusetts Medical School and rodent models that mimic the condition. The next step is to test it in Terry this year.
To put it in layman's term, a lot of diseases are caused by, in the case that we're working on, is not being able to produce a protein. So what we're trying to do is encourage the cells and tissues to actually switch back on the gene that's responsible for that protein, so to make the protein again. So in layman's term, it's like if you look in a car, it's missing a wheel. It's putting that wheel back in. We're not interested in why the wheel's missing, how it's missing, who took that wheel. We're just putting the wheel back in. It's the thought that if we know what's missing, we put it back, that it should have benefits for the patient and should be able to help with their disease.
Dr. Leck's work in the field of Duchenne muscular dystrophy is even more compelling, given that he was born with a rare form of muscular dystrophy called limb girdle muscular dystrophy, a term for a group of diseases that cause weakness and wasting of the muscles in the arms and legs.
My backstory is I was born in Cambodia and my family came to Australia as refugees. I'm the youngest of 7 children. And when I was 10 years old, my sister was diagnosed with muscular dystrophy. And it wasn't until when I was in my late teens and then in my early 20s that I got a definitive diagnosis that I too had a muscular dystrophy. So it's been sort of like my mission to actually understand the disease better and also work on genetic therapies for patients such as myself. Knowing what causes your disease is great and it ends the diagnostic odyssey, but it doesn't keep you warm at night. Every rare disease patient wants some kind of therapy, some kind of treatment, and not generic treatments, but something very specific to their disease that treats the root cause of their disease.
So, the future of gene therapy development definitely looks promising. Whether or not it will lead us to the cures that patients hope for is still unknown, but we have certainly made huge strides in the right direction.
So I think the most amazing part of this journey is not just the hard work that's done here at Yale, but the hard work that is done by our collaborators and how we work together every time there's a problem, you know, or something to solve, how we've worked together with both industry collaborators at Charles River Labs and also our academic collaborators also. So I'm very grateful for our academic collaborators that, you know, if you come to them and put your pride aside and put your ego aside, you know, you can achieve a lot of things. Like me saying, I'm not an expert at this. This is our current problem. This is our current concern. What do you think? And so I think, you know, and that's, I think the key to collaboration, just putting that ego aside. And, you know, and one of the things I'm most amazed about with collaborating with a lot of these industry and academic partners is just the time they've set aside. I was just thinking, this person's too busy to talk to us, Rich, or others at Cure Rare Disease. But, you know, amazingly, they make time for us. Not, you know, 3 months later, but that week. And that's just amazing when, you know, you have this urgency of getting something done very quickly. Just these scientists and, you know, other people that are so busy in the organization making time to meet us.
So where is gene therapy relative to the promises that have been made? And the promises have been made for 20, 30 years that this was going to be a transformative therapeutic approach. And I think in many respects, we are getting to that point. I think right now that is potentially a small number of patients with quite rare disorders, but I think increasingly we're going to see that broaden out applications for things like beta thalassemia, you know, which affect quite large numbers of people, these approaches. And you can see the point coming where it becomes routine to talk about the application of gene therapy as something that profoundly affects the health of patients.
I think the thing about, maybe it's this country or this time, is that, you know, if you're affected by something, you know, you can do something about it. It's hard and it takes a lot of effort and it's really difficult and it'll drive you to places you never thought you'd go and to boundaries that you didn't think were at all possible. But you can do something about it. You can rally communities. You can rally people who are like-minded and believe in a better future. And it may not work, but at least you can try. And at least that's what we're doing, is trying to make a difference.